Hello and welcome to Top Gear. We're in Germany at the Frankfurt Motor Show. Always one of the biggest and most physically demanding of the shows, but this year the tired feet and aching legs are well worth it because this show is packed with new models, a new BMW for example, the first new Land Rover for 19 years and much else besides. This show really stands on the watershed, if you like, between the 80s and the 90s. The last 10 years is an extraordinary decade for the motor industry, the most revolutionary ever, if you like, in the history of the motor car, with more changes in a shorter bit of time than ever before. But in a sense, it's the car industry hostage to its own success. Congestion in every city, the environmental pressure for cleaner cars is greater than ever, as is the demand for more power and performance at every level. But if this shows anything to go by, the next 10 years will be even more radical than the last 10.
Now, this is precisely the kind of car the Frankfurt show's always been known for. A big, muscular machine with the kind of performance you can only indulge on a German autobahn. It's BMW's new 850i Coupe, a 2+2 sports car complete with pop-up headlamps and an engine which is V12, 5-litre, 300 brake horsepower. You get a choice of 4-speed automatic transmission or a 6-speed manual gearbox. And the top speed has been governed down to 155 miles an hour. BMW say they think that's fast enough, and so do I. The acceleration to 60 is under 7 seconds. It proves that you can have a catalyst on a car and it need not be sluggish. And if you want one, you can get one next August, but join the queue and expect to pay around £60,000.
Well, slide across the show into a different market sector and you'll find another stunning coupe that's bound to turn a lot of heads next year, I would have thought, as well as open a fair few wallets. It's the Calibra from Vauxhall Opel, full of family likenesses, but sleeker and smoother than any of its cousins. Indeed, it's claimed to be the smoothest 4-seat production car around, with a coefficient of drag as low as 0.26. But of course, people don't buy coefficients of drag, they buy cars. So what have we got? Well, a nicely raked front end, partly by virtue of the new skinny ellipsoidal headlamps. The windscreen's canted back at fully 64 degrees, but by continuing the roof line and lowering the seat level, they've kept plenty of headroom both front and back. Indeed, the inside's very nicely done, a real soft leather BMW look-alike. There are two engine options, one an 8-valve 115 brake horsepower, the other a 16-valve 150 brake horsepower. I would have thought altogether a real sleeker eater, though of course they're not revealing the price. Now back to Sue on the Porsche stand.
If your dream car is a Porsche, but one that looks like a cross between a 911 and a beach buggy, well, here it is. But don't hold your breath, they're not planning to put it into production, and they've only built it in celebration of the 80th birthday of the company's founder, Dr. Ferry Porsche. It's called the Carrera Panamericana, and it's based on a Carrera 4. It is a convertible, and if you want to take the roof off, they say, well, you simply unzip it. But it's not actually quite as simple as that.
You won't be seeing this one on the road, but Jeremy Clarkson's been driving another very glamorous convertible that you will soon be able to buy, if you can afford it.
The old Mercedes SL had a lot going for it, but it was a bit Americanized, a bit decadent. Bobby Ewing had one, and I think that says it all. This, however, is the new SL. Merck's engineers were given £7 million and told to go away and design the best sports car in the world. There's already a 3.5-year waiting list in Britain comprised of successful hairdressers or people who know state-of-the-art when they see it. There's nothing unusual about the basic layout. Engine at the front, rear-wheel drive, even the suspension is all pretty standard stuff. But the whole thing is awash with electronics. Some of it helps you go quickly, some of it helps you go safely, and some of it, of course, helps you do both. There's even a device that lowers the whole car by 50 millimetres when it's on the motorway. That helps with stability. Now this is the baby of the range, the 140 mile an hour 3-litre. If you fancy a bit more poke, there's a 24 valver, or if you're really serious, a 5-litre V8. Apart from the speed they all go, they're all much of a muchness. They all look absolutely magnificent, even if you fit the standard hardtop. Something I really should have done today.
Certainly the interior is very spectacular, and it's a great deal more commonsensical than most sports cars. Even I fit, and I can see all the dials and the 2 million warning lights. Mercedes have been thoughtful enough to fit any number of cubby holes, which is very useful in a convertible. The two biggest are behind me here. Now you can have seats fitted there, though goodness knows where children who sit in them are supposed to put their legs. It's not all sweetness and light, though. I think Mercedes could learn a thing or two from Jaguar about how to make wood look good in a car, and I also think they could learn how to make a hood look less tatty and one that doesn't leak. I'll tell you what can't be criticised, though, and that's the toys. I've got an electric steering wheel that moves in and out, I've got electric seats, electric windows, and my favourite of them all, this Kurt2Enterprise keyring.
But you don't even need to use the key. Just point it at the door, press the button, and a series of traffic lights confirms all is in order.
Now, it's against my better judgement on the daylight today, but they want me to lower the soft top, so here goes.
Needless to say, the whole thing's electric. You just push a button on the dash and no fewer than 11 motors perform one of the most astonishing routines I think I've ever seen. It takes just 24 seconds to turn one of the most beautiful cars in the world into what promises to be one of the most exciting. The first messages it sends back seem all wrong, a disappointment even. The sheer weight and solidity of the thing are at odds with the aesthetics. It feels big and lazy, a sort of interstate plodder, if you like. It's not until you take the SL by the scruff of the neck that it starts to show an altogether new side to its character. Slight reluctance to get going, it performs really very well, especially in the mid-ranges when the optional automatic gearbox is in sport mode, and the refinement never ceases to amaze. The engine hardly ever intrudes, even when you're doing the sort of speeds they allow in Germany. Well, with the weather improving and on roads like this, the 300's power becomes less important than chassis balance, and on that score it's a major success. The power steering is perfectly weighted, so no one has an excuse for messing up a corner. And the brakes are astonishing. All the time, too, the suspension is feeding information back to a driver right where he wants it, in the seat of his pants.
Most convertibles start out in life as saloons or coupes and have their roofs chopped off later. But this Mercedes, from day one, was always going to be a soft top, and it really shows. There's none of that awful flexing when the front and the back seem to be doing completely different things. It's also supposed to be pretty rigid if you turn it over, too. There are any number of sensors underneath, and if one of them detects that we're about to flip, a roll bar behind my head flicks up in just 0.3 of a second. That's the blink of an eye. Of course, if you don't trust the electronics, you can just run around with it up anyway.
Not only does it help as far as safety is concerned, but also the mesh bit in the middle helps cut wind noise. Having said that, it's entirely possible to have a perfectly normal conversation at speed, with the hood and the roll bar down. Exceed the limit, and things do get a little bit windy. Now, it may sound like Mercedes have thought of pretty well everything. And, well, in truth, they have. What we have here is a car that really is all things to all men. You want a sports car? It'll be a sports car. You want a cruiser? It'll be a cruiser. You want to show off? Go ahead, show off. I wouldn't mind, but it's a sensible choice as well. It's practical, and it'll hold its value. It really is one hell of a car.
Now, about 200 kilometres east of Stuttgart, where that Mercedes comes from, is the fine old town of Ingolstadt, where Audi lives, and Audi's eye-catcher for this show is this topless tourer, officially presented as a design study, but given the success of BMW's 300 series cabrios, bound to be a prime target for Audi, this would certainly fill a gap in Audi's lineup. Based largely on the coupe, they spent a lot of time and effort in improving the safety, so it's got steel shell shock-absorbing seats, as well as a built-in anti-roll bar behind the headrests. Drivetrain and engine options are left open, but I'm sure looks alone would sell this car like hot cakes. Meanwhile, on the other side of the VAG stand, Volkswagen come up with another design study for a futuristic family car, imaginatively called the Futura, based on golf running gear, but the other similarity ends. Among other things, this car parks itself. You simply place it near a convenient spot and it does the rest, and given the congestion of our modern cities, I'm sure we could all do with that. And talking of congestion, Tom Boswell's been looking at the growing river conflict between the powerful German environmental lobby and the super powerful German automotive industry. Are Germans beginning to think differently about their beloved cars?
With one car to two people, West Germany has one of the highest rates of car ownership in the world. There are more roads too, but widespread congestion here, as elsewhere, is compromising free use of the car. Germany's ADAC, the largest motoring organisation in the world, is being criticised for its influence over government transport policy. Alternative motor clubs are being set up now, which provide the breakdown service, but not the pro-car lobby. Even in Stuttgart, the home of Mercedes and Porsche, opinion seems to be changing. But is it just talk?
People complain very much about traffic jams, about noise, about air pollution, but the number of motor cars is always increasing. And of course, many people say other people should use the public transport. The public transport is in general very good in the German cities, but they don't follow their own advice themselves.
Not surprisingly, debate over speed limits is particularly emotive. Traditionally limit-free, many sections of Autobahn are now restricted and pressures for an overall limit increase. Unmarked police cars chasing speeders on the limited sections are now common, something previously almost unknown. Public opinion seems split, 50-50 on an overall limit. Particularly unpopular, though, are the new 100 km per hour limits on the orbital motorways around cities like Cologne. Over 18,000 vehicles used blocking tactics to protest against the imposition of a 100 km per hour restriction on the last section of limit-free Autobahn in Berlin. Formerly part of a racetrack, the stretch of Autobahn had suffered a high casualty rate of 74 per month before the introduction of the limit. In towns too, the car has been subjected to taming measures. So-called calming areas have been designated in towns and cities throughout Germany, much as they do in Holland. A speed limit of 30 kilometres, less than 20 miles an hour, is imposed. Then, as much as possible is done to impede the fast driver. Measures such as plant pots in the street, chicanes, speed ramps, and cobbled surfaces. The government claims that casualty rates have been reduced by as much as 35%, but some road safety experts question whether the £8 million expenditure really slows drivers down at all.
That's a problem in these days. There are some experience from the police, and we see that only about 5% from the drivers do exactly the speed limit to 30 kilometers. And so there are some directives to do additional instruments in the future in the street, maybe more trees, maybe more narrow points, and of course markings along and in the streetways.
It is, however, in environmental protection where German attitudes to cars are changing most. Aided by dealer campaigns, catalytic converter use is already the highest in Europe. And when you renew the road tax, there's a rebate of up to £350 if your car has a catalyst. In Stuttgart, there's even a proposal to ban cars without converters on smoggy days. A sticker comes with your catalyst as proof. And to discourage one person per car commuting, there are discounts in stores with your bus ticket. Even the mayor is feeling the pressure.
I don't see much change in individual life. And I'm also a bad example. I always point out that I never drive alone in a car, but because I have a driver, yes. But this is no convincing argument for other people.
But at least opinion is forcing German car companies to innovate to solve the problem. The industry's diesels are some of Europe's first to use catalytic converters, and some new VW diesels have a turbo, not for power, but for cleaner combustion of the fuel. BMW have become world leaders in developing hydrogen cars. This 7 Series has a 100-litre pressurised hydrogen tank, and the only drawback of this super clean engine is a 25% power loss compared with its petrol equivalent. In the unlikely event of a hydrogen leak, the car is ventilated automatically. But today's concerns may soon give a market advantage to Germany's powerful car industry.
Our lips shouldn't touch.
Move over, darling.
I like it too much. move over, darling. That gleam in your eyes is no big surprise anymore. 'Cause you fooled me before. I'm all in a spin. Move over, darling. About to give in. Move over, darling. And though it's not right, I'm too weak to fight it somehow. 'Cause I want you right now.
The brightest British star at the show is on the Land Rover stand, who've chosen Germany to launch their first new vehicle for 19 years. It's called the Discovery, designed to fill the yawning gap in their range between the fundamental workhorse, the Land Rover, and the luxury top-of-the-market Range Rover, a gap so accurately exploited by the Japanese. Same wheelbase as the Range Rover, permanent four-wheel drive with manual diff lock, two engine options, the proven V8 3.5-litre petrol and a brand-new 2.5-litre turbo diesel, not before time, one might say. Inside is very nicely done in a pale blue-grey. They've raised the rear roofline and put in these rather nice curved quarter lights to give a greater sense of space and light. Storage boxes wherever they can be squeezed in. Wheel cavalierly carried on the back door in true Japanese style. And they've put in these two children's dicky seats, complete with lap straps. Price is not yet revealed, but it can't be as low as the Japanese competition.
It's not been an easy week for Jaguar, with their profits sent nosediving by fluctuating exchange rates. And the German car market's always a tough one for them, fighting against Mercedes and BMW on home territory. So, to steal a bit of thunder here and perhaps to cheer themselves up, they're launching the 1990 XJ6, with its engine uprated from 3.6 to 4 litres. Now that pushes the top speed up to 140 miles an hour. It also improves the acceleration at the bottom end of the rev range. At the same time, they've made a few changes inside. They've reverted to a much more traditional style dashboard and come away from the rather glitzy and a bit controversial fluorescent one.
Well, the Japanese have really pulled out all the stops here at Frankfurt to make a big splash. They all have either new cars or new ranges on display. Toyota, for example, have come with the new Celica, softer and rounder than the current model, which may please the wind tunnel. It hasn't noticeably improved the looks of this good-selling sports car. Interior completely redesigned, suspension tinkered with to improve the handling, engine range beefed up at the bottom end, otherwise very much an evolutionary rather than a revolutionary change. But hidden away in the corner of this stand is a rather interesting concept car. Interesting not so much because of its looks, which are hideous, but because of what's under the skin. It's got a 4.5-litre unturbocharged and supercharged engine with 5 valves per cylinder that delivers 300 brake horsepower to a 6-speed gearbox on the rear axle. Subaru have chosen Frankfurt to launch a new range of 2 Sierra-sized saloons and 3 estates. They're called the Legacy, which sounds a bit like an American TV soap. On the Honda stand, the real Bobby Dazzler is the Ferrari chasing NSX that could really launch Honda as a builder of quality sports cars. But far more important, as far as their market share is concerned, is the very much more mundane Accord, still very conservatively styled, but longer than the current model, with more interior space and a new 2.2-litre engine at the top of the range. And finally, Mazda have come here with the Pretty Little Elan lookalike MX-5. Front engine and rear drive, 115 brake horsepower, reportedly very sprightly. But far more significant in market terms is a new 3-car 323 range, bigger engines, more rigid bodies, better specification. Some engineers are saying that these cars could set the standard for compact and medium-sized family cars for the next few years. But enough of new cars for the moment. What do Germans do with their old cars? Well, would you believe, football?
Way to play football. Well, back here at the show, Peugeot have come here to needle the luxury German car makers by launching their new flagship model. It's the 605, a shapely big saloon with a very Peugeot family look to the front end. It is front-wheel drive. It has a range of engines from 4-cylinder 2-litre right up to 3-litre V6 and 24-valve at the top end. And that one has 200 brake horsepower, and it also has an electronic suspension management system to give the car a really smooth ride. Inside, they've borrowed a few tricks from some of the British luxury car makers. They've got polished walnut, lots of lovely leather to give it a really sort of country club interior feel. It goes on sale in France next month, but we'll have to wait in Britain until next May for it to arrive, and we think the prices are going to be in the region of £14,000 to £20,000. Under the skin, it shares the same floor pan and a lot of mechanical parts in common with the new big Citroën, the XM. Well, that's the car that Chris Goffey has been driving out on the roads of rural France.
If a Frenchman wants his French car to create a good impression when visiting his favourite Champagne Chateau, what better choice than the innovative Citroën SM? Still beautiful nearly 20 years on, but it was a commercial disaster. Citroën's engineering of its latest models, the AX and BX, have as a result adopted more conventional lines. And the money those cars have made means today the company's on a sound financial footing. Well, now it looks as though Citroën are going back to their roots in the shape of this car, the first new big executive saloon for 15 years, the Citroën XM. And in the Bertone shape, you can see distinct echoes from the past of the beautiful SM lines. The XM certainly fulfills the principal requirements of an executive saloon. It has power, comfort, style and prestige, but it's in the suspension that Citroën has broken new ground. We've had cars where you can control the shock absorber settings before, but on the XM the stiffness of the springs can change as well. And it does it automatically, anticipating the car's movements. How? Well, an onboard computer takes information from a number of sensors describing the car's behavior. They continuously monitor vehicle speed, rate of accelerator movement, braking effort, steering angle and rate of change, plus angle and speed of body roll. The information is used to vary the spring and damper rates so that in normal driving, soft springing and damping gives a smooth and comfortable ride. But when required to perform more vigorous manoeuvres, the suspension immediately stiffens up to make the car more controllable. Well, that's the system in theory. How does it work in practice out here on the roads of France? Well, you have to say the XM is one of the best handling Citroëns yet, and that's going on some very high standards indeed from models in the past. It's sharp, it turns in, it holds the road extremely well, and there's none of the front-heavy ploughing understeer that you used to get in the CX. The degree of ride comfort is debatable, though. I think my old DS used to float along over these surfaces rather better than the XM, but certainly the ride was nowhere near as well controlled. And this computer that senses what the car's going to do and then sets up the suspension to handle it really is extraordinary. Now, to power this sleek shape along the French roads is a familiar sight under the bonnet. It's a new version of the 3-litre V6 that was developed for a generation of cars from Peugeot, Volvo and Renault. In this form it develops 170 brake horsepower. But Citroën say that in the UK, where 80% of XMs will go to business or fleet owners, the most popular engine will be the 2-litre 4-cylinder 130 brake horsepower unit with fuel injection. Citroëns have always been noted for their big boots, and the XM, as you'd expect, is no exception. With the folding parcel shelf, plenty of access to the load area, and with the seats fully folded down, there's a tremendous amount of space inside. It's almost the leader in its class. Unique, I think, is this very interesting idea of a glass screen that can stay down when the hatchback comes up, and that effectively seals off the passenger compartment and stops any wind and rain blowing in when the tailgate opens. And in hot weather, it also keeps the air conditioning going. Where the XM does score is on interior space. Even with the driver's seat fully back, the passenger has adequate legroom. And with the driver's seat in a more normal position, then the legroom becomes extremely generous. Both passengers get their own vents in the door pillar here, a face-level vent with fresh or cool air, and that's a very nice feature indeed. Inside the driving compartment of the XM, it's well trimmed and well equipped. The traditional Citroën single spoke steering wheel enables you to see the instruments and the minor controls which you operate with your fingertips. The spoke is also equipped with simple radio controls. Now in Europe, when they give you air conditioning, they don't give you a sunroof, but in Britain, all XMs will be equipped with a power sunroof. So let's see how it goes on the move. Accelerating hard in the V6 reveals the performance potential. This car will do 137 miles an hour flat out thanks to the excellent aerodynamics. But the 2-litre injection unit is also very nice to drive. It's the engine fitted to the Peugeot 405. It's not all good news from the driver's point of view though. These screen pillars are very thick and on the passenger side they cut into the wing mirror quite considerably. And the view out of the back isn't very good either. That rear window is very narrow, and especially parking the car takes quite a lot of judgment. However, it really is a driver's car once you start to throw it around. Out on the old Grand Prix circuit at Reims, the handling was a revelation. Just how suspicious, hard-headed company buyers will view this very compact suspension remains to be seen, but on this showing, Citroën will have no trouble selling the 9,000 cars they've targeted for the UK in 1990.
Well, that's about it from Frankfurt. Now, which of these cars would I wish to pack in my suitcase to take home with me? There are several, of course. This one will do for starters, the new Ferrari, the 348, called the Mini Testarossa because of its similarity in appearance to its big brother, but no minnow in terms of performance. 0-60 in 5.6 seconds, top speed 170 miles an hour. A trifle too close, I would have thought, for Ferrari's comfort to the Testarossa's own performance. Well, that's it. Next week, back in the UK, we look at three executive saloons and where you go to find the odd bit for the old car, the auto jumble, of course. So see you then. Until then, I'll be the same.